So today here we will discuss only the few things overview of when we connect any distributed generators or any renewable energy sources based distributed generators, or you can say distributed energy resources. This is called in US and Canada, particularly microgrid, maybe microgrid or maybe nanogrid, or maybe you have AC microgrid or DC microgrid or hybrid AC-DC microgrid, or you can connect directly at transmission level at higher voltages beyond 132 kV. Then what are the issues faced by our grid? So that we wish to discuss today, right? And of course, what are the solutions proposed by various researchers in past maybe few 5-10 years papers? And what are the probable solutions, and which part it still needs solution? That is also very important, because see, all the solutions given by researchers, they are not feasible sometimes, right? So maybe because of the cost, or maybe because of the complexity, or maybe both. So today we will discuss just few things about what is the impact of different renewable energy sources based generations on microgrid, right? So I am not going to deal with what is microgrid, how it is defined, what is AC microgrid. I think microgrid means microgrid. It can be any type of microgrid, right? So now when we talk about the sorry this today's lecture, this contents of this lecture I have covered from the book, of course my own book, and some papers, IEEE papers, that is also my own, but still for plagiarism purpose I need to acknowledge that I'm using those things, those references. Okay, now if we consider the utility, our own utility, when we talk about microgrid, then we are dealing with the power distribution network. We are dealing with the distribution network. So in our country, distribution network is normally divided or classified as primary distribution network and secondary distribution network. So anything between 4 kV to 33 kV that comes under primary distribution network, 4 kV to 33 kV. However, 33 kV level nowadays does not exist in our country, except one or two place. So we have 66 kV, and below that directly we have 11 kV, right? That is the voltage level. So 66 kV is not a distribution level. It is also not a transmission level. So it is a sub-transmission level. And above 66 kV, we have 132 kV, which is a transmission level. So anything at 132 kV or above that comes under transmission, anything at 66 kV that is sub-transmission, and anything at 11 kV or below that comes under distribution level. So with this background, we know that we have a distribution utility or grid, I call it. Or you can also call it distribution utility or distribution system operator, DSO or DISCOM, right? So distribution company, anything you can call, this we have somewhere here, right? Where my cursor is at present on the screen. Then we have at 11 kV different consumers are there, of course. So we have 11 kV HT consumers, high tension consumers. So whenever any 66 kV line, sub-transmission line is available at the distribution substation, we call it distribution substation because it is the substation in our country which is existing in most of the areas where 66 kV line is available. And then we have a power transformer that is 66 by 11 kV, which is going to step down the voltage from 66 kV to 11 kV. So anything on 11 kV side, a distribution network starts. So we have the distribution transfer substation here, where we have 66 kV by 11 kV step down is there using transformer. And then on the output side, 11 kV side, we have different 11 kV HT consumers. We can call it normally feeders, distribution feeders. So we have different feeders at 11 kV side. I have shown one of the 11 kV feeders. You can see here the cursor. And of course, we have a load connected somewhere here, right, where I have mentioned customer load. So we have different types of load. Maybe we have domestic load or residential load. We have agriculture load. We have commercial load. We have industrial load, so on. So we have all such types of load on somewhere right hand side where the cursor is. We have the utility or grid or distribution company on left hand side. This is not there, right? Keep in mind, this is not there initially. So we have utility on left hand side and loads that are connected on right hand side. So the flow of power is unidirectional from left to right, right? So in distribution network, that's why we called our distribution network is radial in nature. So the meaning of radial in nature is that we have the source or the grid on left hand side and we have the source on right hand side, and power flow is left to right in one direction. It is unidirectional. Now, but we know that now government is or government of India is encouraging the installation of different renewable energy sources based generators. Maybe you can consider photovoltaic generators, PV based solar generators, or maybe you can consider wind based generators, okay, particularly in coastal areas where wind velocity is sufficient. Or you can consider biomass based generators, right, where you can use some biomass to produce the power, and you can further use or you can connect it to the grid also. Or you can use maybe some tidal or wave energy where it is there. Or you can use offshore or onshore wind DG, right? Or you can use fuel cell also. You can use fuel cell also, which nowadays government is also encouraging. So we have different types of renewable energy based generators. And these generators, we call it as distributed generators or DG. We call it as distributed generators or DG in our country. In some developed countries, they call it as DER, distributed energy resources. Distributed energy resources. So when we are going to connect this distributed generators at different points or different locations along this 11 kV feeders, 11 kV distribution feeders, maybe you can connect DG here, you can connect somewhere DG here, here at any point, right, at any location. So normally when we connect this different types of distributed generators, maybe solar, wind and so on, we can connect these generators through to this distribution feeders at some particular point, and this point is known as PCC, point of common coupling. We know that it is known as point of common coupling. So we can connect any type of DG at any location at point of common coupling on distribution 11 kV feeders, right? Now the question is, at what location we can connect? So optimal placement of DG, that is another big area, right? At what location I am going to install the DG, that is, that needs some optimization algorithm. Why optimization? Because normally we put the DG at a particular location so that voltage at the last consumer, that is maintained. Utility will call this in technical term as voltage at the tail end, that should be maintained within prescribed limit, plus or minus 10% of the nominal value of voltage, right? So this is very important point. But anyway, we are not going to deal with the optimal placement of DG. That is another another area of research. You can search it. The question is, when we connect this distributed generators at particular any location on the feeder, the distribution 11 kV feeders, then our grid, which was earlier radial in nature, power flow is unidirectional from left to right. Now when you connect DG somewhere near the load, somewhere here, power flow does not remain radial, unidirectional in nature. Radiality of distribution network is disturbed, is not there, is not maintained. So your power flow becomes bidirectional, maybe from left to right, or maybe from right to left because of the incorporation of DGs, because they are also capable to feed power into the system or network. So when we connect this distributed generators with the utility or with distribution utility, the utility is going to face several challenges and issues. We need to think about those challenges and issues, and of course probable solutions if it is there. So that is our discussion for this lecture or this session. Okay. Now, what is distributed generators or distributed energy resources? So IEEE, in one of its standard, IEEE 1547, it is mentioned that any small, medium or large scale generations which is going to connected at point of common coupling, and which is going to connect and which is going to take part in the system or grid, that is known as distributed generators or distributed energy resources. Now the question is, why government is encouraging to connect a DG with the distribution network? So there are several reasons for that. The very first reason is the pollution reduction. I hope you read today's newspaper. It is mentioned that because of this pollution and the greenhouse effect, there is an increase in temperature of Earth by 1.5 degree. Right, it is mentioned in today's newspaper. So pollution reduction is must, right? Pollution means in pollution in terms of greenhouse gases we are talking. We are not talking about some other type of pollution. Of course, we do have some noise pollution and so on, but we are restricting to only greenhouse gases. So when we have, and of course, the last Kyoto Protocol, that is also in indicating that we need to reduce the pollution, and we need to earn some carbon credits for that, right? And that's why government is planning to replace or close most of the fuel conventionally non-renewable based power plants like coal and other types of power plant. Government is planning to close it permanently, and that's why government is encouraging the renewable energy sources based power generations, right? So that we can incorporate it and we can reduce the pollution. That is one of the major objective or major thrust. And nowadays government is also encouraging hydrogen fuel cell based power generation also, right? Even hydrogen fuel based vehicles also government is encouraging. There is a forum in our country like Smart Grid Forum. We do have forum of this vehicle also. And government is encouraging this thing also, so that even railways are also planning to start hydrogen fuel cell based engine, right? So that the pollution, they are planning to replace most of the diesel engines in our country. And the Kalka Simla Express is one of the best example, right? I hope you know, remember that between Kalka and Simla, the one train is running, which is known as toy train. And it is governed by diesel engine, but now it is creating pollution. So to replace that, the government is encouraging, or they have given the projects to replace the diesel engine with some other alternative like battery storage or fuel cell, right? But of course, this have also challenges. So this is also one of the major thrust of the government. So this is one of the important issue. The second issue is the improvement in efficiency. So efficiency also plays an important role, right? See, till now, when we talk about distribution system, efficiency is not that much important. What we learned from our undergraduate or postgraduate studies is that two things, two difference. For transmission system, efficiency is more important because we are transmitting power in bulk form, in maybe in terms of megawatt. Whereas for distribution system, efficiency is not important. What is important is percentage voltage regulation. And that's why when we deal with distribution system, percentage voltage regulation is more important, which is not important for transmission system. But this is not the case nowadays. After incorporating renewable energy sources, we need to think, distribution utility has to think about increase in efficiency or reduction in losses, right? That's why government is more focusing on AT&T losses, aggregate techno-commercial losses. Earlier it was known as transmission and distribution loss. Now it is known as aggregate techno-commercial losses. So this is very important thing. Facilitate network connection. So obviously reliability of the supply increases because of the incorporation of DG, because you have multiple sources. Earlier, when no DG is there, you have only utility. You have to depend completely on utility. If utility fails, you do not have power. But nowadays, if you install or incorporate DG at different location, if utility fails, at least you can feed power, you can supply power to at least some critical loads like military campus or hospitals, right? So this is a really important point. Diversify energy options. Energy options we have available in our country that is only from utility, right? There is no trading available from some other private power producers or power distributors. If I wish to get connection, electrical connection, I have to take it from utility or state electricity board only, right? We do not have options like SIM card we are using in our cell phone. We can take SIM card from any of the suppliers, right? Maybe Vodafone, Idea, or Jio, BSNL. Such type of options in energy is not available. However, it is available in developed countries, right? Just give you, in New Zealand, they have 12 different energy operators. In Texas, they have 3 different energy operators. So it is up to the consumers or customers that if I wish to take energy, if I wish to purchase energy or electrical connection for my house from one energy operator or some other or some third, it is up to me, right? So I have to see what benefits or what schemes they are providing. So such type of diversified energy options are not available in our country, but we hope it will be available in next future. Reduction in threshold for building new power plants. If I do not have DG, to cope up the demand, load demand, I have to build the power plant, let us say, with 200 megawatt capacity. Now, if I have a DG, I have installed, let us say, 10 DGs, each of 5 megawatt. So total demand that is 50 megawatt that is catered or that is given by DG only, right? Different DGs only. So when I wish to build the power plant, I have to build the power plant with only 150 megawatt capacity instead of 200 megawatt capacity. So that threshold, peak value of building the power plant in terms of megawatt, that can be reduced if I install DGs at different locations. Construction times, that can be reduced. If I wish to construct a big power plant, then it is very difficult to find the locations also, because I have to acquire the land and so many issues are there in our country, right? We have witnessed the two important what you called Yojana, right? Maybe Narmada power affected in Gujarat, MP, Rajasthan, and some Cogentric power project in South region. So this all are because of the larger construction times, and they need huge land, so many things, right? So these things we can avoid. And last, but not the least, that is the location at which we can install the DG that is very close to the consumption. So what we are doing till now, we are generating power in bulk form at one place in power generation, right? Then we step up the voltage and we transmit the power using transmission lines. Then we further step down and then we distribute the power. So our power is produced at some other place and X place, let us say, and the loads are situated at Y place, and the distance between X and Y is, let us say, 200 kilometers. So we have to transmit and distribute the power over 200 kilometer distance. This increases AT&T loss, aggregate techno-commercial losses of the utility. To avoid this, what we can do, instead of doing this, we can install the DG at actually the location where loads are there. So instead of transmitting 200 megawatt power, we have to transmit only 100 megawatt. So obviously, that AT&T loss that can be reduced. Of course, utility has also several advantages if they adopt incorporation or connection of DGs into the network. Security of supply increases, reliability of supply increases, right? Because you have alternative power supply available in the form of DG. Overloading of the feeders, that also reduces. Earlier, you have to transmit a higher value of power. After installation of DG, you have to transmit lower value of power. So overloading capacity reduces. Peak load reduction, major thrust or major area or issue. Now, why peak load reduction is important? Maybe in some Delhi region or some other region, there are two distribution companies. One is Tata and another is Adani. So these two companies, during summer season, maybe for half an hour or 1 hour, they have to take some extra measures to cater the peak load demand in summer season. So this is very important. And keep in mind, maybe after 2-3 years or 5 years, peak load reduction is extremely important because of incorporation of electric vehicles. I hope you know, remember, Government of India is encouraging electric vehicles. And many companies are also manufacturing electric vehicles, right? Including Tesla and Nissan and maybe Toyota and so on, Mahindra. So we know that when electric vehicles we use, electric vehicle can work in two different modes. It may work in vehicle to grid mode, or it may work in grid to vehicle mode. So grid to vehicle mode means it takes supply from the grid. When it is available in the charging station, then multiple electric vehicles are connected in the charging stations. And depending upon what type of chargers you have used at charging stations, maybe fast chargers or slow chargers, multiple electric vehicles are charged. And because of that, your peak load demand increases. But we do not know at what period vehicles are available for charging in charging stations. And of course, these vehicles can also work in other mode also, vehicle to grid mode, in which they can supply power back to the grid. But this is possible only when your vehicles are at rest for long period of time. Maybe you parked your vehicle in near your offices, right? Maybe for 8 hours, then they can supply power back to the grid. But again, this depends on what is the state of charge available in the vehicle, right? It cannot possible that if only 40% state of charge is available in vehicle, then there is no need to supply back to the power back to the grid, right? You need the power, vehicle needs power. So this is also a big and challenging issue of electric vehicles, and particularly it is directly going to impact peak load, right? So how to cope up or cater this peak load demand, that is also an important issue nowadays. And that's why peak load is very important issue in demand side management. The next is the reduction in grid losses. As I told you, AT&T losses that needs to be reduced. Network related benefits that is obtained or achieved by utilities, distribution utilities, that we are not concerned, okay, what benefits they are going to get. But of course, they are also going to get several benefits. Now, when you install the DG, economics of DG also play an important role. The DG has two costs. One is fixed cost and another is variable cost. And this fixed and variable cost, that is both costs are applicable during, before the operation of DG, means before the installation of DG and after the installation of DG. Before operation, during operation. So when we consider the fixed cost, before the operation it involves the licensing cost and metering cost. Whereas after the installation of DG during running condition, the fixed cost involves the schedule maintenance cost, insurance cost and tariff cost. What are the tariffs, right? And separate tariff need to be designed for DG. When you install the DG, separate tariff is required. The variable cost, that involves before the operation the connection cost, whereas after the operation during running condition it involves fuel cost and taxes. And unscheduled maintenance, some fault is there, suddenly something goes wrong, then you have to take the generator or in maintenance, and that also involves cost. So now the issue is, what are the different problems due to incorporation or penetration of this distributed generators? So of course there are several issues are there. We are going to discuss only one or two issues. But the different issues I have listed, maybe the several other issues are not there in the list, but that also you need to think or consider. So the first issue is related to the maximum power point tracking control of PV system. So this first issue is related to the PV based generators, that is when we use solar based generators. We know that we have to track the maximum power from the solar panel. Why we need to track the maximum power from the solar? The reason is, we know that solar radiation, that is not constant, that changes, that depends on several factors, right? Of course, intensity of solar and so on. So when solar radiation changes, as according to the IV characteristic of PV panel, I hope you remember or recall, the on x axis of IV characteristic we have voltage, and on y axis we have the current. The maximum voltage is the, on x axis is the VOC, open circuit voltage, and the maximum current available on y axis is the ISC, short circuit current. VOC is available when the open circuit voltage is available when no load is connected at the terminal of PV panel, so IL is zero, and ISC is available when you short circuit, so VL is zero, then ISC you will get, IL become ISC. And when IL is zero, your VL, terminal voltage or load voltage, that becomes short circuit voltage. So when solar radiation changes, the photon current changes. So the current on y-axis changes. So because of that, the maximum power point also changes. The locus of maximum power point also changes. But you're surprised that if solar radiation changes and then current changes, and this maximum power point locus varies in a small narrow band of voltage on x-axis. Small narrow band of voltage on x-axis. So somehow, anyway, if it changes, then we have to track at different locus of maximum, of the point where we can have maximum power from the PV panel or PV system, right? And keep in mind, we have the multiple panels connected in series and parallel, because one single PV panel can produce only 0.6 to 0.8 volt. So you have to connect this in series and parallel so that you will get some reasonable voltage, let's say 28 volt, right? 28 volt is the most common voltage available in our country or used in our country. So for this panel, you need to think about maximum power point tracking. So if I wish to track the maximum power point because it changes because of change in solar radiation, then I need some algorithm. Then I need some algorithm. Am I audible?
Yes, sir.
Okay, fine. So, thank you. So when I wish to track the maximum power point, I need some algorithm. So most of the manufacturers and researchers, they used two algorithms. And these algorithms are known as P&O algorithm, perturb and observe algorithm. Perturb means you create some disturbance and observe, right? That is the meaning. And second is the conductance based algorithm, inverse conductance based algorithm, right? The first algorithm, that is perturb and observe algorithm, is used to track the maximum power point locus on the for the PV panel on its IV characteristic, considering only one sensor as the voltage. So when the voltage available, so when there is a change, means when you consider the power, right? So when there is no change in power, difference of the power is zero. So let us take, I take one sample of power at, let us say, at particular one instant, right? I can also take the sample of power at earlier instant, let us say T minus delta T instant. I acquired one sample at T instant. I can have another sample at T minus some delta T instant, before some value, delta T, some period. I have two samples. Let us take the difference of this. If difference is a zero, then you are already at the maximum power point. So your point is always maximum power. You can track that. If it is not zero, then you have to find out whether this difference is greater than zero or less than zero. And accordingly, you have to increase the reference voltage, right? And this is how you are going to get the maximum power. You are going to track the maximum power point on PV system or PV panel. This thing is also applicable for wind-based generators, because for wind-based generator also, wind is not constant. Velocity of wind is continuously changing. So wind-based generating system is also not going to give us constant power. The power is intermittent, right? So for wind-based generators also, we need to acquire, we need to track the maximum power point at different instances. So for that also, you can use some this algorithm or some other algorithm, so that you will have maximum power point even though there is a change in velocity of wind, right? So that you can also consider. So this is one of the issue, though I can explain more on this, okay, but I think this is not required. The second issue is power quality. So we know that power quality also plays an important role, and when we talk about the power quality, then we need to define the quality of power. So as per IEEE 519/1992 standards, amended in 2012, again amended in 2018, quality of power is nothing but the combination of quality of current and voltage. And quality of voltage and current is nothing but the deviation of voltage and current with reference to some nominal value for certain time duration, right? That is nothing but the quality of power or quality of current. So this IEEE 519 standards has defined several terms associated with power quality. These terms are voltage sag, reduction in voltage, sudden voltage swell, sudden increase in voltage, flicker, voltage flicker. Then you have oscillatory transients, you have waveform distortion, you have noise, you have harmonics, you have interharmonics, and so on, right? So all these things are very, and why power quality is important? Because if I consider solar based generators, then output of solar PV panel is in the form of DC voltage. So of course we need to connect a buck boost converter so that we can you can also acquire or track the maximum power point by connecting buck boost converter. Because if I use the buck boost converter, I can vary the duty ratio, the switch, electronic switch we are using. And if I vary the duty ratio, I can vary the maximum power, locus of maximum power point. So you can also, when we use solar based generators, then output of PV panel you are going to give to the buck boost converter, then you can connect charge controllers, and then you can connect some inverters, because our loads are AC, so you have to convert DC into AC. So when we talk about solar based generators, then inverters we have to use, and those inverters are going to inject harmonics into the system, into the grid, into the network. That's why power quality is an important issue. Same way, if I going to use the wind based generators, we know that there are normally two types of generators they use. In our country we use doubly fed induction generators for wind system, and for developed countries they use permanent magnet synchronous generators. There is a difference. Each has advantages and disadvantages. We do not concerned about that. But when we use wind based generators, then also we use inverters, and they are going to inject harmonics, which is going to deteriorate quality of power. So power quality plays an important. The third issue is integration issues and islanding issues, third and fourth. So integration issues are also very important. Islanding issue is also important, and these two issues are described by IEEE 1547 standards, right? So that we will discuss. If we will see after this slide, we will discuss the integration and islanding issues. Of course, we do have the change in coordination philosophy of several devices like recloser. Because we use at distribution network, we use fuse, right? Normally we use high rupturing capacity type fuse. We use reclosers, we use relays, normally overcurrent relays, and we also use the another devices that is known as circuit breaker, right? Just to disconnect the feeder. So when we use these four devices, fuse, recloser, relay, and circuit breakers, at that time coordination among all these four devices are very important. If coordination is lost, then obviously for particular fault the some other breaker will operate, right? This is not the correct good thing. So selectivity is an important issue when we deal with the coordination philosophy. So coordination philosophy also changes because of incorporation of distributed generators, and that also we need to think. After that, voltage regulation and losses are very important, because when we incorporate distributed generators like solar and wind into the distribution network, then voltage regulation changes, even losses are also going to change. So that also we need to analyze. Effect of harmonics we have already discussed with power quality. So I think that is not required here. Okay. Then increase of short circuit level. This is very important thing. See, earlier let us assume that we do not have any distributed generators connected, no solar, no wind, nothing. We have only utility, we have only loads. So what we are doing? Utility has some fixed capacity, right? Fixed power carrying capacity, distribution capacity. So what we do is we installed or we select the switch gears, circuit breakers, isolators, all that, depending upon the capacity of utility. Now as and when you have connected distributed generators, maybe solar or wind, then they are also going to inject power and current into the system or network. So now you have, let us say I have 10 DGs. So 10 DGs are going to impact power into the system, right? It can they can incorporate the power into the system. So we have utility power plus the power of 10 DGs. So both are vectorially added, and that because of that, the short circuit level of the system or network increases. So earlier we have designed our circuit breakers and isolators considering no DGs are connected. Now as and when you connect the DG, short circuit level increases, so you have to replace those circuit breakers and isolators. which involve cost. So this is very important point, right? Last important issue, that is the grounding and transformer interference. That is also very important because for distribution network, grounding plays an important role, right? I hope you have studied different types of grounding, maybe resistive grounding, resonance grounding, Peterson coil and so on. So that you have studied, so I am not going in that detail. But because of grounding, several other issues are also there that we will see later on. So let us consider the third issue, that is the integration issues and islanding issues and change in coordination philosophy issue, right? So to understand that, before we start that, we must know at what voltage level we are going to connect what type of DG. So at low voltage distribution grade, usually at 230 volt to 415 volt, we connect photovoltaic panels, right, PV panels, or maybe we can connect combined heat and power based generators, okay. This is normally used in developed countries. In our country, we do not use CHP based power plant. At medium voltage, distribution voltage 11 to 66 kV, you can connect small hydro power plant, biomass power plant, tidal and wave system, and even small industrial combined heat and power. At high voltage distribution grade 66 to 132, you can connect large industrial combined heat and power plant, large scale hydros, and offshore wind parks, right? So instead of at the bank of the sea, you connect with some inside the sea, some wind park or wind systems. So that also you can connect, right? That also that is possible. And of course, at transmission level, you can connect any type of large power plants. So this is important thing when we connect DG with the grid. So this is very important point. Okay. Now the point is how we are going to connect this, how we are going to connect this DGs with the our conventional grid. So when we wish to connect with the conventional grid, we need to use the IEEE 57 series of interconnection standards. We have to refer this first. So in this standards. In 1547.1, they have mentioned the test procedures. When you wish to connect your DG with the grid, what are the tests you need to follow, right? So that is mentioned here. Then 1547.2 is a complete guide. 1547.3, they have mentioned regarding the exchange of parameters between grid and distributed generators. If you have connected the DG, distributed generators, at 12 kilometers from the utility, then within this utility and generator, assuming that you have a communication line between utility and distributed generators, then what information or parameters are going to exchange through communication line between utility and DG? So this is mentioned in 1547.3, and 1547.4, the guide is given for island systems. So what is islanding and all that? That we will discuss later on. Okay, so some general requirements. So when we are going to integrate or connect DG with the grid, we know that we need to follow some synchronization procedures. Voltage should be same, frequency should be same, phase sequence should be same. So some synchronization procedure we need to follow. Then we need to also think about what type of isolation device we are going to use. If something goes wrong in the DG, right? Or then how we are going to disconnect the DG, how you are going to protect our DG. So this is also an important issue, right? And that we need to consider. Of course, some other issues are also important, like the impact of fault, right? So whenever fault occurs, how it is going to create an impact on the system or on the DG, that is also another aspect we need to think. Okay, now with this background, let us see what is islanding issues. This islanding issues is mentioned in 1547.4 of this IEEE standards. Okay, so further you can refer it in IEEE 1547.4 standard. So islanding is defined as any situation or condition in which your system or your network is electrically isolated from the other parts of the network. But when it is islanded or isolated, it is going to feed the power to that particular island. So for example, just to understand, let us say we have the circuit breaker connected here. We have the utility source here. We have different feeders, 11 kV feeders. I have shown only two feeders, feeder 1 and feeder 2, both are 11 kV. And then we have, it is connected, this feeder is connected to local load with DG is connected. So when this circuit breaker becomes open, right, when it this becomes open, then this area or network is islanded. This area or network is separated or islanded. So this is known as islanding, right? It is an electrical isolation from the main grid network, okay? Similarly, if you consider some higher station like 66 kV station, different 11 kV consumers, then also you can see there is one DG here. You can consider this as island or this as island, that also you can consider. Now, what are the types of islanding? Islanding can be classified as intentional islanding and unintentional islanding. Intentional islanding is normally carried out for stability improvement of the whole network. This is not done in our country, but it is carried out in developed countries like US, Canada, Australia, New Zealand, and European countries. So it is carried out for stability improvement of the whole network. Whereas unintentional islanding is carried out for reliability improvement. And this is what we are doing in our country, right? Unintentional islanding. Now let us see each intentional and unintentional islanding one by one. We will first discuss the intentional islanding. So to understand the concept of intentional islanding, what we have done, we have developed one setup in the laboratory, right? We consider some devices in the laboratory, and then we have developed several algorithms. And then we have carried out some controlled islanding, right, or intentional islanding. And then we have, we note down the results. So to consider, to study this, we develop a setup, and the setup is like this. This setup is known as TAMU synchrophasor testbed setup. The TAMU is, the name is given because it is, the setup is situated at TAMU, that is Texas A&M University, US, where I work. So here you can see that what we have done, we have considered one software, right, in which we carried out the simulation of a large system, right? You can see here I have mentioned 1354 bus European grid we have modeled. So we modeled a European grid, which is very large. It involves 260 generators, 1354 buses, and 1991 lines or feeders. It also involves 40 PMUs, phasor measurement units, of course, that is not required for us. Then this is also connected, this software RTLab is connected with OpelRT simulator, through which we have carried out hardware in loop. And then, of course, we do have some substation PDCs and servers. It is substation phasor data concentrators and servers. We do have some PI historian server. And then we have some GE server applications. We have a very big wall display It is almost the screen of the class. It's a very big wall display. So whatever we have, we modeled here, and whatever is the output available, that is displayed on this Mitsubishi Vault display. Okay. So if you just see whatever the modeling we have carried out, we considered almost 1354 buses, 260 generators, as I told you. And you see background of this here, different areas, you can find different lines. So these are the nothing but actual single line diagram of this 1354 bus European grid, right? And then we carried, what we have done, we have overloaded some line, you can see by red color. And then we measured something, we do something. And what we have done, we have intentionally, we have not created islanding. But when we observed that there is a possibility of blackout in this region, then deliberately we have created islanding. So what we have done, we found that, okay, there is a possibility of blackout. So what we have done, we have completely segregated some part of the network or area. So if a blackout is there, and if we have not intentionally done islanding, then without controlled islanding or without islanding, intentional islanding, you can see the voltage profile of four different areas. These areas are this, right? You can see area 1 to area 4. So we have measured the voltage profile in per unit, and you can see that for area 2 and area 3, you will find that the voltage collapses. For this area 2, it will go as low as maybe 0 or almost 0.01 per unit, right? So we wish to avoid this. And if we wish to avoid this, then what we have to do is, we have to go for intentional islanding. So we have identified some areas and some lines, and we have deliberately removed that line. So when we have done this, we use some algorithms that we have to predict whether islanding is happened or not, right? So we need some indices, and we used several indices known as observability indices and vulnerability indices. And based on that, we have predicted that, okay, islanding is, there is island is formed. Now it is required to carry out intentional islanding. So some triggered command is issued and intentional islanding is carried out. And when we did this, then we found that the before controlled or intentional islanding, there is a loss of almost 4000 megawatt load. But if you adopt intentional islanding, then the load loss of load or load shed, that is only almost 70 megawatt. And the detail of this you can find in the paper mentioned here. It is a paper published in SIGRE committee by myself and the another person, Professor Kuzanovic. So you can again go through and find the details of this. All these things are mentioned there. And if you see, after intentional islanding, if I measure the voltages of this area 2, earlier it is going to collapse up to 0 per unit, almost close to 0. Now you can see it goes up to 0.7 per unit maximum, right? That is also transient. So this can be the advantage of intentional islanding, which we are going to have. Okay, then. Okay, now with this background, let us see why and when islanding occurs. What is the reason why islanding, for the occurrence of islanding? So when there is a switching of any circuit breakers, right, maybe manual or automatic, depending upon the condition, because of that, islanding is going to occur, number one. Number two, when the operation of some sectionalizing switches or reclosers, that is going to take place, then islanding also occur, right? So this is these are the reasons why islanding is going to occur. Now what the question comes, if islanding occurs, what is the problem? So let us see what are the hazards and risk of islanding. Now whenever you can see, whenever I show you this diagram, when this circuit breaker is closed, connected, this whole network right, that comes under the utility source or grid. Is that clear? And when this is opened under the utility, only this much network is there. This is completely islanded. Okay, this is very important what we need to discuss here. Now when island is formed, island means it will act as an unregulated power system network, unregulated. Earlier when circuit breaker is closed, it comes under the utility. So utility is responsible for maintaining voltage and frequency, right? Regulated, it is regulated by utility. But as and when island is formed, voltage and frequency are no longer under the control of utility. So that means if voltage and frequency are not under the control of utility, then you need some control mechanism at distributed generator level. But it is not there because it is very costly to have the controlled mechanism with DG, right? So the immediate risk is whenever island is formed, even though it is beneficial because when island is formed, you are going to supply power to some critical loads depending upon the capacity of your DG. But still, if this whole islanded network, that becomes unregulated, and you need to have some control over voltage and frequency. Power quality, as I told you, that is also very important, and this also needs to be considered. So voltage and frequency provided to the customers, that vary significantly. So that is also going to take the another aspect. So but anyway, we are not going to discuss. The another important aspect is the personal safety, which is very less concerned in our country. See, whenever island is formed, I hope you remember that diagram where circuit breaker becomes open, so island is formed. Now in utility, if I am the in charge, what is my duty? The duty is, if you see again the same diagram, when this circuit breaker becomes open, this island is formed, right? So now as an engineer in utility, what is my duty? My duty is to send the lineman, just see why circuit breaker has opened, to carry out the maintenance so that I can immediately connect back this utility with the islanded part. So my duty is to send the lineman to check why this islanding has occurred, right? Why this islanding has occurred. So that is a very important issue. So when you send the lineman, keep in mind the other side, right? The other side is energized because islanded part is live. DG is providing power or feeding power to the critical loads in an islanded network. So your utility personnel may get an electric shock, right? Unless and until proper care that has to be considered or taken. So this is personal safety is also an important issue. And the another very important issue is out of synchronism of recloser. Now in the distribution network, normally we use the reclosers. Now what is reclosers? The question comes. So reclosers are nothing but the device equipped with, this is recloser. So reclosers are the device normally equipped with circuit breakers. So whenever there is some fault here, suppose let us say somewhere here there is a fault. So normally this is protected by the fuse. Okay, let me show you again the same diagram. Okay. Now let us see that. Suppose this is my recloser, right? It is a circuit breaker, but it is equipped with reclosing facility. Now if fault occurs somewhere here where load is shown, somewhere here, right? This is your small feeder. So if there is a fault here, Which device will operate to take care of this fault? Yes. If there is a fault here, which device will operate? Yeah, the question is, if there is a fault somewhere here where the cursor is, okay, then which device will operate to provide protection against this fault?
Circuit breaker, sir.
No, why circuit breaker? This, what is this?
Sir, fuse will operate.
Fuse, yeah. Operator one, sir.
Fuse will operate.
Right? So fuse has to operate.
Fuse operator one, sir.
So fuse has to operate, right, for feeder one in this case. But keep in mind, whenever there is a fault somewhere here, 80 to 90% faults are transient in nature. What do you mean by transient in nature? That means faults, they, whenever they occur, they will die out after some time period automatically. So if suppose in a year span, 100 faults occur, then out of 100 faults, 90 faults are transient in nature. So they may die out after some time period automatically. So now my question is, if this 90% of the faults are transient in nature out of 100, then there is no use to operate this fuse. Am I right?
Yes, sir.
Because the fault is going to die out after certain time interval. What is the time interval? Maybe 0.1 second, 100 millisecond. There is no use to operate fuse, right? Because if fuse operates, then unnecessarily there is a disconnection of power. And again, another thing, as an engineer from this substation, you have to send the lineman to rewire the fuse, right? So it is not advisable to operate the fuse. So that's why here, instead of utilizing circuit breaker, we replace this with the circuit breaker with reclosing facility. So that's why this is known as reclosers. So reclosers are nothing but circuit breaker with reclosing facility. So now, whenever there is a fault here, what will happen? Fuse is not going to operate for any fault. Recloser will operate first. And what is the meaning of this? Let us say here at this point, fault is going to occur at t equal to 0.2 second, 0.2 second. So we know that this fault can be transient, it can be permanent, we do not know, right? So what is the way to find out whether the fault is transient or not? This circuit breaker will open, right? This, it will, this becomes open. And again, you have to reclose it after some time automatically. So this breaker will operate. Let us say this breaker will operate. This fault occurs at t equal to 0.2 second. This circuit breaker will operate, let us say, after 100 millisecond. So 0.2 plus 0.1, 0.3 second, this breaker becomes open. After some time, right, after some time delay, we, this contacts of the circuit breaker, we reclose it. So let us say we reclose it, this contacts at 0.4 second, right? So it, this becomes recloses. What happened? Fault is going to occur at 0.2 second and we are going to reclose the circuit breaker at 0.4 second. So between 200 millisecond, if this fault is transient in nature, it will automatically die out. So for 90% cases, recloser, when it opens and again we reclose it, your system becomes healthy. Because 90% faults are transient in nature. So there is no need to operate the fuse. Is it okay? This concept is known as fuse saving concept. This concept is known as fuse saving concept in the utility. Right? Now the question comes, sir, for 10% cases, if fault is permanent, then what to do? Then recloser becomes open. It, again, we reclose it at 0.4 second. Still, if fault is permanent in nature, then this recloser becomes open, okay, automatically, and it remains in open condition, right? And then fuse becomes operate, it operates, fuse operates, and it is going to disconnect the feeder. So this is the case when we use this fuse saving concept. This concept works perfectly all right. Why? Because we need coordination between the characteristic of fuse and characteristic of recloser. We can easily do the coordination, right? Subject to, we do not have any distributed generators connected, right? We have radial structure, we have utility only on left hand side, no DG on right hand side. As and when you connect a DG at different locations, then the coordination between this fuse and recloser, that is going to disturb. And that is what we are more concerned.